A bodybuilder mistook an aphrodisiac for pre-workout supplement. This is what happened to his brain. JC is a 37-year-old man presenting to the emergency room unconscious. Paramedics tell the admitting nurse that they saw him have multiple seizures in the ambulance. JC was a bodybuilder who was getting ready for a show. Being a veteran of the space, he had a good idea of what does and doesn't work for him during prep. Being 37, he noticed over the last couple of years that his body started putting on fat in places that he never thought about before. Every time he needed to get prepped for a show, the fat put onto these places would just seem harder to get rid of. This isn't something that's out of the ordinary when someone ages, but JC was a competitor. He needed to be in the best possible shape, so this fat needed to go. JC read online about a supplement called yohimbine. Others at his gym had talked about it, including his coach. This is a natural product derived from tree bark that used to be FDA approved for erectile dysfunction. The rescinding of that approval doesn't stop people today from using it for such, but not only that, these online articles kept mentioning that yohimbine can act exactly in the places where all his stubborn fat accumulation was happening. He concluded, yohimbine would not only be a great addition to his daily supplement stack, but also to his product lineup. JC ran a small supplement business. Recently, a tax credit was put into place whereby he could get some money back if he did some research and development. He'd purchase raw powder wholesale and he'd distribute it online. He had happy customers and his product was good, but it was when he would take small cuts of his large purchases to mix his own concoctions that he would have trouble. Many bodybuilding supplements are white powders, and yohimbine is no exception. While creating his mix, JC got a phone call. He stepped away. When he came back, some labels were obscured and everything looked similar. He proceeded to mix, not realizing that he dumped more than 300 times the regular yohimbine dose in what was supposed to be his pre-workout drink. At the gym now, JC was training. He held off on his pre so it became a peri-workout drink. As he puts the bottle lid to his mouth, he one-shots the mix. Immediately after ingesting this massive yohimbine dose, JC didn't really feel anything wrong. He kept going on with his sets, but within minutes, he started noticing that he was shaking. He tried to stop, but he couldn't. His heart started racing and he felt a sense of doom shrouding over him. An uncomfortable sensation started permeating through his jaw as he started feeling like he couldn't breathe. As he tried to continue on with his sets, he could feel his heart beating like it was inside his skull and his eyes were getting pumped out of his head. In the bathroom, JC's vision was blurred. A sensation rippled through his cheeks and liquid flooded under his tongue as he emptied his stomach into the toilet in a way like never before. But it wasn't over. JC started shaking violently, losing consciousness. The gym manager hears the commotion, goes into the bathroom, and she finds him on the floor. She calls for 911, and he's brought to the emergency room, where we are now. At examination, the medical team notes that JC's heart rate and blood pressure were slightly elevated, and his seizures kept recurring. He doesn't regain consciousness in between each convulsion. When they look at his eyes, both pupils were dilated, which is better than if they were different sizes from each other, but still not good given that JC would stay unconscious after each seizure. And at 2 hours after admission, JC's heart rate and blood pressure had doubled. All of this giving the medical team some clues as to what's happening. Yohimbine is a natural product derived from yohimbe tree bark that was at one point FDA approved for erectile dysfunction, and today still used, not approved by any government agency for the exact purposes that JC took them for, to help burn fat in stubborn areas, but there's also some hallucinogenic properties that it can have, leading way to some of those uses too. But how exactly does it do all of these things? Some natural products are stimulants, and others are depressants. Based on just these names, we can guess how our bodies will react under the influence of either. Stimulants causing fight or flight reaction, and depressants inducing rest and digest. Clearly, if JC's heart rate, blood pressure, body temperature are high, and they're getting higher, his pupils are dilated so as to let in more light, like he's running away from a wild animal that wants to eat him, and his brain is setting off massive amounts of discharge to the point where he shakes and convulses without regaining consciousness, then we can say that yohimbine is probably a stimulant. Put together, everything that he's experiencing is sympathomimetic toxidrome. Sympatho referring to the sympathetic nervous system, the one that's responsible for fight or flight response. Toxidrome being a word formed from syndrome, a grouping of symptoms happening together, toxi from toxin, an exogenous substance that somehow made its way into the body, and mimetic, meaning that the toxin is inducing a problem mirroring the effect that would be caused by a massive nonstop adrenaline release. But how is it doing that? This brings us to the idea of transmission. Signals from the brain are sent to all parts of the body through the nerves. Signals can be to turn things on or off. Knowing that there exists a part of the nervous system that signals for fight or flight, and another part that signals for rest and digest. But for example, the heart reacts differently to signals from each one, then we could guess that the transmitter for fight or flight could be different from the one for rest and digest. And we know that this is what's happening because the neurotransmitter responsible for fight or flight is something called noradrenaline, related to adrenaline, all involved in sympathetic nervous system response. The thing about fight or flight versus rest and digest signals is that in the body, either signal can be promoted or they can be blocked, because signals can be to turn things on or off. The words used to describe this are agonist as the promoter and antagonist as the blocker, ant from anti meaning against. Take, for example, this commonly known medicine. It's used for attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. It's a stimulant by the very nature of directly promoting fight or flight when excessive amounts are taken. Interestingly, its chemical structure shape is similar to that of noradrenaline. In this case, we can say that this medicine is an agonist, but knowing that JC is having a massive outflow of sympathetic response, what does all of this make of yohimbine? We've already established that there's one part of the nervous system that signals for fight or flight, and another that signals rest and digest. There are specific nerve fibers that are sympathetic for fight or flight, and there are nerve fibers that are parasympathetic for rest and digest. Inside these fibers are structures that receive neurotransmitters specific to the type to propagate the signal. For sympathetic fibers, these are adrenergic receptors, labeled this way because they react to noradrenaline. Of these, there are also specific subtypes that provide different function. In a genuine fight or flight situation, all of these will fire off to evoke the response, but when targeted specifically, they can behave very differently. Hours after being admitted into the hospital, JC's condition was unpredictable. He's conscious again, but he's agitated, disoriented, and confused. Because he's too stimulated, they can try some sedatives to help counteract that action, but there might be something better. This brings us back to agonist and antagonist. If JC's having sympathomimetic toxidrome, then we know that yohimbine is a stimulant. If agonists promote and feed forward a signal, then we could expect it to be an agonist too. But the problem is, yohimbine is an antagonist, meaning that it blocks noradrenaline signal in the nerve fiber. And not only that, it's a competitive antagonist, meaning that it will displace whatever's there in order to occupy the spot to stop the signal. For adrenergic receptors, there are subtypes of alpha and beta, and among these, there are even more subdivisions like alpha 1 and alpha 2. You may have heard of beta blocker medicines for blood pressure, and that refers to beta adrenergic receptors. Yohimbine acts on alpha, which gives us some more clues as to what's happening to JC. One important tissue that nerves connect to is the smooth muscle of blood vessels. Typically, alpha 1 receptors are known to be there, signaling to constrict the blood vessel, causing blood pressure to immediately shoot up. This is what's happening to JC, but this happens when the receptor is agonized, but yohimbine is an antagonist. So why is it doing the opposite? Well, in normal function, the body has a way of balancing itself through something called feedback. Naturally, when the body swings one way, it will try to compensate in the opposite direction. And while alpha 1 receptors reach blood vessel muscle, alpha 2 receptors are inside the central nervous system, going from nerve to nerve. We know adrenaline and noradrenaline are what's sending signals here. We know that when our body is in a state of fight or flight, adrenaline and noradrenaline flood the system. But that fight or flight response normally is short-lived, on the order of minutes. And if we know that the body performs feedback, then we can guess that stopping this fight or flight response is somehow built into the sympathetic nervous system, explaining what yohimbine was doing to JC's body. The alpha 2 adrenergic receptor in the brain binds noradrenaline and then tells the brain to stop releasing it. This acts as a check against the system in normal function, but if yohimbine is there blocking alpha 2, this mechanism is shut off. Normally, the brain is in equilibrium, meaning that there's still some noradrenaline release when you're doing regular daily activities. But when it doesn't get shut off and it keeps getting released, the effect builds up quickly because normal function isn't happening anymore. The vomiting, the incredibly high heart rate and blood pressure, the recurring seizures without regaining consciousness. All of this because a massive dose, 300 times the normal amount of yohimbine, was accidentally consumed by JC in just a couple of sips. But this isn't his only problem. In the setting of massive overdose, comparing to regular function to describe what's happening isn't accurate. When we say yohimbine is a competitive antagonist to alpha-2 that assumes therapeutic dose, but when excessive doses are present, there are so many more yohimbine molecules present than there are places for it to bind on alpha-2 receptors. This excess floods the body, binding to alpha-1, blocking that signal. This results in the blood vessels dilating, and the heart wants to compensate for this by beating faster and harder, and it can do that because the alpha-2 pathway is turned off, leaving excess noradrenaline to run amok, even stimulating the beta adrenergic receptors too. But there's only so many adrenergic receptors of any subtype to the amount of yohimbine that JC took. In the brain, serotonin is another neurotransmitter. The brain is connected to the gut by something called the vagus nerve. Serotonin helps modulate smooth muscle contractions all along the GI tract, and with excess yohimbine present, aberrant activity starts to happen, including the vomiting that he experienced. In other documented cases of yohimbine overdose, there are descriptions of unconsciousness for several hours coupled with priapism, pushing forth the notion that it's something that can be used for erectile dysfunction if you ignore the side effects. Yohimbine is also known to have dopamine activity when taken at very large doses, all of this indicating neurologic toxicity because he's unconscious, and cardiotoxicity because his heartbeat and blood flow throughout his body are so unstable. At any minute, things can immediately turn for the worse for JC. Could there be any way to directly remove the massive amount of yohimbine right out of his body? No. But knowing how it works enables us to give medicines that directly counteract its effect. If yohimbine is an alpha-2 adrenergic antagonist, then the answer would be to give him an alpha-2 agonist. But what would that look like? Recently, there's been reports on the United States East Coast, specifically Boston and especially Philadelphia, that horse tranquilizer has entered into the illicit supply. It's called xylazine. It's mixed in usually with fentanyl, and the way that it functions is that it agonizes alpha-2 adrenergic receptors, pushing the feedback mechanism forward, heavily blocking any semblance of fight-or-flight response from happening, not only in horses, but in humans too, resulting in tranquilization. Interestingly, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration has approved an antidote for xylazine accidents in horses known as yohimbine. The news reports and the videos that you may have seen about horse tranquilizer might have included images of skin lesions that appear on the users. It's basically an open wound that can fester and rot flesh and expose bone, muscle, and soft tissue underneath. Do you remember that there's alpha adrenergic receptors on blood vessel smooth muscle? Well, if xylazine agonizes alpha, and alpha causes vasoconstriction, then it's possible that these lesions are coming from xylazine constricting the blood vessels so hard that they starve of oxygen and die. This would make the most sense if they appear at the site of injection, but reports say that they can appear in other places on the skin too. However, at the moment, this is speculation in humans because the reality is we still don't know much about how xylazine specifically is exerting its effect. However, there is some new information out that could contribute to the conversation. Receptor systems can often engage in crosstalk, modulating each other's activities. And one system that could interact with adrenergic receptors are opioid receptors. It's unclear if the mixing of xylazine into fentanyl is purposeful specifically because of this particular detail. In some cases, there are reports of people specifically looking for just xylazine now. But mechanistically, the antidote for opioids doesn't work for just xylazine, at least not in the way that it does for other opioids, because just like adrenergic receptors, opioid receptors also have subtypes, and this research suggests it towards one of smaller prominence. The research is still very early. On the clinic side, in humans, this is what we see. We'll see the research develop some more over time, but we're not sure how those skin lesions are happening, and we don't know how well yohimbine would work as an antidote in humans for xylazine, despite evidence of it working in horses. But mechanistically, knowing what we know now, this all gives us a better idea of how JC could be treated. In humans, a common alpha-2 agonist that we use is a medicine called clonidine. This technically should counterbalance his yohimbine dose. If noradrenaline is out in excess in JC's body, blocking beta also would be a good idea. If his seizures keep recurring, and seizures are sudden chaotic discharge of electrical activity in the brain, then giving him some medicines to slow down his brain and his nervous system will help. Yohimbine passes through the body fairly quickly. Half-life is a measure of how long it takes for the blood level of that substance to be reduced by one half. For yohimbine, it's an hour or two. Knowing that yohimbine is broken down by the liver and then excreted in the urine, the medical team collected samples of JC's urine throughout his hospital stay, and they could see the yohimbine levels cut in half, but at a rate much slower than an hour or two, because in the setting of overdose, regular function to describe what's happening isn't accurate. 1 hour after the blood pressure medicines were given, JC's heart rate normalized. He was able to regain consciousness, but he might not be out of the woods just yet. The medical team needs to do some tests to make sure that everything is normal. And while they were doing those tests, they knew cognitively he was all there. Over the following 24 hours, the medical team were able to confirm that JC's blood tests, physical, and neurologic exam were normal as he was discharged from the intensive care unit and he was able to make a full recovery. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.